Several years ago, long before I was invited to be part of the staff here at the church, I was asked to be a summer camp counselor with junior high students. And I had never done this before. So I didn't know kind of how the game plan went. And so I remember this, on the third night of summer camp, the speaker had already basically given an invitation for students who wanted to make some sort of step in faith. And I really didn't expect much, and to my surprise, actually a whole bunch of students took some kind of step that night, including one that I had started to connect with. And after the speaker was done and there was some space after the service, the student wanted to just sit and talk for a while. And so we did. We sat and talked about what was going on in this kid's life and how he wanted to grow closer to God and the steps he could take to do that. The problem was, I was horribly ill-equipped to have that conversation. See, at that point, I really understood very little about the life of a junior higher at that point. It had been several years since I was one myself. And I really didn't know what to tell this student as far as how to actually acknowledge God in his life and to grow in his faith with God. So it was kind of a difficult conversation. I mean, this is the thing that you want to happen, right? You want to see junior hires have a faith moment with God. It's what you want. But when it happens, now what? Now what do you do? How do I help a junior hire, someone who's very different than I am, grow in faith? I wasn't sure the answer. But I was pretty confident in my abilities as a summer camp counselor. I mean, day three, this is pretty awesome, right? Until I left the sanctuary and was confronted by one of the female counselors. All my other boys had been pelting praying girls with water balloons. So much for counselor of the year. That didn't work out. You know, but sometimes things happen in life and you really want it to happen, but then it happens and you don't know what to do after that. And that's kind of where we're going to find ourselves today, that question. When something you really want to have happen happens, but you don't know what's next. The next step can sometimes elude us. Now what? If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to the book of Jonah. We're going to be in Jonah chapter 3 today. If you were here last week, Dave walked us through Jonah chapter 1 and chapter 2. And Jonah chapter 1 is the most well-known part of the Jonah story. And that's where he gets swallowed by a really big fish. And the reason is this. God had called Jonah to go to a city called Nineveh and to share his message there. Now, Nineveh was not in Israel. So this was a foreign nation, somewhere outside the borders of Israel. And Jonah, told to go essentially east to this place, went west. He went as far away as he possibly could from the place God had called him to go. But God wouldn't be thwarted, and so even while he was on a boat, a big storm came. Jonah found himself in this place where he realized the storm was his fault. He convinced people to throw him overboard, and Jonah thought he was going to die. And part of us wonders if maybe that's what he wanted in that moment, to die rather than go to Nineveh. But God, in his mercy and judgment, swallowed Jonah with a fish, right? So the fish took Jonah for 3 days, and after 3 days, finally spit him out on dry land. And in that process, in the end of chapter 2, you have this Jonah who is repentant and very, very thankful for what God had done in his life. But I'll tell you this. Despite the fact that God came into Jonah's life and saved him, and Jonah recognized God's movement, Jonah still didn't want to go to Nineveh. That had not changed. And so today, in chapter 3, we're going to see this call once again. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. Now this more or less is basically a mirror of what happens at the beginning of chapter 1. God's asking Jonah to do the exact same thing just two chapters later after the whole fish incident. And the question would be, now, after Jonah had experienced all this, would Jonah actually obey and would he actually go to Nineveh? Because Jonah really didn't want to go. Now, if you've seen this story before, there's probably a number of reasons why Jonah wouldn't want to go to Nineveh. One of them is just being afraid, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. But I think there was something much deeper going on in Jonah. There was a real reason, for him, a moral reason, why he didn't want to go to Nineveh, even if God was telling him to. And that's because Nineveh was essentially Israel's enemies. And so in order to get us in the mindset of Jonah, in order to help us understand exactly what he was going through, what he was feeling, what his fears were, we're going to do something that, of course, I love a little too much, and that's use a map. Here we go, map. Okay, great. There's three blobs on this map. The brown blob at the bottom, that's Judah, and the green blob at the top, that's Israel. See, Israel had already gone through an internal split, and so there was the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom generally kept the name Israel, while the southern kingdom took on Judah as their name. And so at this point, this is pretty commonly known. That purple blob, that's the Assyrian Empire, and Nineveh's right there in the middle of that purple blob, okay? So this is kind of how the world was going to look during Jonah's time. See, Jonah actually shows up one other place in the Old Testament. If you go to 2 Kings chapter 14, you get the story of Jeroboam II, a king from the northern part of Israel, the green blob there, who, as it says in the Bible, did evil in the sight of the Lord because he didn't help the Israelites overcome their false gods. He didn't steer people toward God. But nonetheless, even though he wasn't someone who honored God in that way, God prophesied through Jonah that Jeroboam would actually expand his borders. So that whole northern section of the green blob where it says Damascus and Hamath, that actually wasn't under Israel's control when Jonah started. But Jonah had prophesied that ultimately Israel would take that section of land and they would secure the borders that way. Now, we don't know what role, if any, Jonah had in the actual operations of that, but Jonah's prophecy is documented in 2 Kings. He went to the king and said, this is what's going to happen. You're going to take these lands. And best we know, Jonah didn't protest with this particular assignment. He didn't run to Joppa and end up in the belly of a whale. Like, that's just not what happened here. And we can't know exactly why, but I suspect partly because this particular request wasn't so daunting. Because this is well within line of the kinds of things that Jonah would want to see happen. This is his nation. His nation's going to grow. They're going to expand and secure their borders. That's all in Jonah's best interest and the best interest of the Israelites. This is one of those easy prophecies to give. It's like all good news, you know? And so there's the only other record we have of Jonah in the Old Testament. The Assyrians, the purple blob, had a very different story going on at that point. While Israel was reaching some of its highest military power, Assyria was declining. They were really strong a couple decades earlier. Under different leadership, that purple blob had gone all the way almost to the border of Israel. And so Israel was actually deathly afraid of the Assyrians because they were like right there. And the Assyrians were not nice people. They conquered through fear. That was their tactic. And so when they took over places, they did horrible things to the people they took over. And they did this so that if the Assyrians came knocking on your door, you were already terrified before the army even showed up. That was their plan. It was very effective and helped the empire grow immensely. But at this particular point in time, when Jonah's in place here with Jeroboam II, the king of Israel, Assyria has actually shrunk. Their military victories had gone south, actually, and their diplomatic ties were falling apart. And suddenly, Assyria finds itself in sort of a weak and vulnerable place, at least in comparison to what it had been before. So Israel is at its peak. Assyria is declining. Now, if you've ever played the board game Risk, you know what to do here. When your enemy is declined and they're weak, that's when you wipe them off the board completely. You don't let them sit there and grow to be a bigger power. No, you destroy them and you take their cards. That's the way that the game works, right? And that's what the people of Israel were kind of hoping was going to happen to Assyria. I mean, their evil, their wickedness had been well documented. God had already spoken against it. And when we find in the story, this is the way that God introduces Assyria to Jonah. Their wickedness has grown. We know that God does not approve of the way that Assyria has gone about their military victories. We know that. And so the Israelites probably had to hope at least a little bit that now, while Assyria is down and weak, that God's judgment would strike swiftly and eliminate their enemy from the board. That would provide them security. That would provide them peace. And no matter who you are, whether you're the king, a citizen, or a prophet of Israel, it had to sound pretty good to think that maybe God would finally rid you of your enemy. These were real fears. Assyria was not an idle threat. And I want to show you this next map just so you understand just how big of a threat Assyria was. Because somewhere between 30 and 60 years after the story of Jonah, the map would look like this. Assyria would grow and would actually take over the entire northern kingdom in 722 BC. The Israelites who lived in that section would be scattered. They'd be sent into exile all over the Assyrian Empire. And although they would continue to refer to themselves as Israel, their sovereignty was gone, and the northern kingdom wouldn't recover it for a very, very long time. Judah survived a few more years, but they would ultimately meet a fate similar eventually too. But I mean, here this is real, right? Jonah is afraid of the Assyrians because they might do something like this, and he was right. They are going to take over Israel. These aren't nice people. These are Israel's enemies, and so for Jonah to go to Nineveh, one of the core cities here, is basically to go and help the enemy. It feels like the ultimate betrayal. It's not just that he's scared to go, it's that he's basically turning his back on his people. And Jonah, back in chapter 1, chapter 2, had to come to terms with the fact that ultimately he was not a prophet of Israel. He was a prophet of God, who knows no borders. But this was a very difficult lesson for him to learn. And I'm not sure it ever fully sunk in. But the question would come now. Now that we're in chapter 3, and God's asking Jonah once again, go to Nineveh, would he go? And verse 3, Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. He didn't flee, he didn't go the other direction. There's going to be no big fish in this particular story. Jonah's going to go to Nineveh, the city that's in the heart of Israel's enemies. And he's going to proclaim to them what God had asked them to. Now, Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. Which, by the way, if Jonah gets to write his script, that's exactly what he wants to have happen. In 40 days, Nineveh is going to be overthrown. That's what Jonah wants to happen. But Jonah knows this, that this warning here is conditional. The hope on God's part is that Nineveh will repent and God will be able to extend his mercy. That's the outcome that Jonah doesn't want. But here he is in the city. Now the city's really large, and it says 3 days. Based on what we know of Nineveh, it probably would have taken about 3 days not to go from the entrance to the exit, but to actually get through all the major centers in Nineveh. So in order to fully proclaim this message to everyone, give everyone a chance to hear it, it was going to take him about 3 days. He's into his first day and begin to proclaim this message. Now, this has to be a little bit scary because Jonah is a foreigner in a city that's known to be hostile to foreigners. I mean, it's a little bit like a Celtics fan going to a Lakers game. It's just a dangerous job, right? You got to be careful with that. And here he is proclaiming a message that none of them would really want to hear. Destruction, no one likes to hear it when a prophet prophesies destruction. It would have been very easy, if almost not predictable, that the Assyrians in Nineveh would have taken Jonah's life for even mentioning these kinds of things. But here Jonah is, day one. The big question on the table is, what's going to happen? Will Nineveh hear the message? Will they ignore the message? In verse 5, the Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed on all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. Day one, Jonah didn't even get to go through the entire city. He begins preaching this message, and people hear about it. They accept it, and word travels faster than Jonah can. And by the end of his time there, everybody is changing their tune. When Jonah's warning reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. The person of highest standing in this city said, I'm going to relinquish this. Instead, we're going to look toward the God of Israel. This is not an outcome that anyone really could have possibly expected, maybe except for Jonah. Because this is a foreign nation. They have no business with the God of Israel. Why? How on earth would they decide to suddenly follow this different God? Heed the words of this random strange prophet who showed up in their borders. What could possess this city to do such a thing? Now, I think there's actually a couple of answers to this. See, we already talked about this. Assyria as a whole is actually having a really hard time. They find themselves politically shrunk compared to their status before. So they know that everything is not going well. They see what their ways and what their violence has gotten them. They know that it's not panning out. And so they're actually open, probably for the first time in a long time, to another message. Someone else saying, here's another option, something that might actually work. They recognize that what they were doing wasn't helpful. And you see that in the next couple verses. This is the proclamation he, the king, issued in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let people or animals, herds or flocks, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink. But let people and animals be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. I mean, check that out. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. They were self-aware. They knew what they were doing, and they knew where it had gotten them. And on this day, hearing the message of Jonah, really the message of God, they were convicted. And this city, the entire city, great city, turned around and started to do something different. They probably had some hope. Maybe by doing this, we'll be spared destruction and maybe we'll even find a better way. Maybe we'll even be prosperous again. It's possible that a nation like this too had tried many other gods and they'd failed them time and time again. Maybe this God will help us out. But nonetheless, in one of the most incredible mass conversions you see in the entire Bible, an entire city decides to follow the God of Israel. Well, now what? Well, God knew what he was going to do. When God said, or when God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. This was the outcome that Jonah most wanted to avoid. Jonah wanted the destruction. He wanted the calamity. This is not conjecture. We know this from the next chapter in verse 10. This is exactly not what Jonah wanted. And so Jonah, as you can guess, is not going to be too thrilled with this outcome. But to understand more of Jonah, you're going to have to come back next week. Today, I want to look at the Ninevites and their story and God's love for foreign people that wasn't part of Israel. See, as a preaching team, we started batting this around a couple weeks ago. We knew that we were going to get to this point in the story, and we asked ourselves the question, what does it look like for Assyria, for Nineveh, to turn toward God? And quite frankly, we don't know. Because there's a lot of things missing from this equation. See, the Israelites, they worship God through a whole set of sort of cultural institutions. They had the temple, their sacrificial system. They had priests and Levites who helped facilitate these things. As far as Israel understood, they sort of had the corner market on God. And Nineveh doesn't have any of that. Very different culture, very different background, very different history. Not called out to be the people of God, but actually in many ways the very enemies of the people of God. What does it look like for them to turn and have faith? For them to turn toward the ways of the God of Israel? And quite frankly, I don't know. I can say with relative confidence that it probably didn't look a whole lot like religion in Israel. It couldn't. They didn't have the same institutions, the same structures. So they're going to have to figure out how to serve the God of Israel in their own way, with their own cultures and their old customs. And I don't know what that looked like. I know, for one, it didn't last particularly long. Ultimately, we saw the map. We know what Assyria is going to do. But even in this short period of time, for people who are genuinely trying to search and find God, what does it look like? I don't know. Because when the Spirit of God moves in something that is beyond me, I don't get to decide what it looks like. Jonah didn't get to decide what it looked like, and goodness knows Israel didn't get to decide. If they got to decide, Nineveh would have been wiped off the map. God's mercy moves beyond our wisdom or our understanding. And today, seen in 2017, we find ourselves in a very different kind of world. Now, there are places in the world where there are countries that have majority cultures and religions. That's definitely true. But, I mean, think about where we live and the kind of communities that we're in. There's majority cultures, but really, anywhere you go, you could find a different culture, a different way of life, a different religion. A lot of times, there are neighbors, the people who live right next to us. And these people who surround us, they're not evil, necessarily. They're just different. They're outside probably what a lot of us who grew up in church anyway picture a Christian being. Yet God's mercy is radically advancing toward them, has a desire to meet them. And we, as God's people, are sent into that. God's Spirit moves before us into the hearts of people way before we ever get there. And so here's what tends to happen. I mean, not always, you know this, but here's what can happen. is as we engage the people around us, the people that we have influence with. Now, sometimes these people are our actual neighbors. If you're like me, I've had trouble actually getting to know my actual neighbors these days. It's something that I'm working on. But a lot of times we find sometimes it's our actual neighbors, people right around us, or people that we interact with daily. So coworkers, or maybe classmates, or people who are on their kids are also on your kid's soccer team or something like that. There's people who you interact with all the time, who you come into contact with. Some of them are like you, some of them are completely different than you. But before you ever got there, God's Spirit was moving forward. And as you get to know the people that you have influence with and you hear their stories, you will discover that there is brokenness in our world. There's brokenness in pretty much every person's life. And no matter who you are, and actually no matter what your faith, there's an opportunity to enter into that brokenness and to hear people's stories, to hear what's going on. And sometimes, not entirely unlike Assyria, when we find ourselves in a place of weakness or a place where we know that everything we've been doing to this point hasn't been working the way that we want, we become open to a message from someone like Jonah, or more appropriately, a message from God. And as God's sent people, we sometimes get the privilege of being the ones who share that message. Now, it's not our responsibility what happens with it. God's Spirit's been already moving, and it's going to continue to move. But like Jonah, we're sent. Not necessarily sent far away, although we do have a lot of missionaries who are called to being sent all over the world. Our game plan is a lot like theirs. See, missionaries, really the only fundamental difference is the geography to which they're called. But for the rest of us, if we're not called outside of our current geography, we are called to it, and we are still sent. And we really embrace the community around us the same way that missionaries would embrace it anywhere else in the world. When we don't understand someone's culture, their background, their faith, the things that are important to them, the way that they've been living their life to that point, we have the opportunity to simply begin to make relationships, to make connections, to enter into the brokenness and be a friend. And sometimes, just like people all over the world have experienced, when you're a friend, the things that you say matter. And it gives us a chance to say, you know, there's this God who's made every possible difference in my life. It might be that his mercy wants to come to you today too. Will that be accepted every time? Goodness, no. But many. And then you find people who are having this incredible encounter with God, and then we have to ask the question, now what? Because maybe that person didn't look like me or think like me or have the same background as I do, and now they're having this faith experience with God. What am I supposed to do with that? Will they even fit at my church? Do I know how to talk to them? Am I going to try to give them my way of being a Christian, or am I going to see what the Holy Spirit's going to do into their way of being a Christian and finding the balance between the two? It's complicated. It's messy. But the Spirit is always moving faster than we are. You know, in our country right now, if you've been following the news at all, there's this really big question on the table. And the question basically is, who gets to be our neighbor? And all three branches of government are heavily invested in this debate right now. And a country has to do that. U.S. citizens have to do that. You have to ask the question, who gets to be my neighbor? That's what nations do. But Christians, even while being a citizen of a nation, Christians ask a deeper question, a question that's a little bit more relevant to our discussion of being followers of Christ, of being a people sent out. And the question isn't, who gets to be my neighbor, but rather, who can I be a neighbor to? In the New Testament, there's this story, you might have heard it before, it's oftentimes just called the Good Samaritan. It's a parable that Jesus tells. And it's a story of a Jewish man who goes through some really difficult things and is desperately in need of some help. And some other Jewish people walk right on by, even some of really high social standing. And then this other man, a Samaritan, very much a different culture, a different background, different geography, shows up and helps the man. And by the end of the parable, you learn that the neighbor in that situation was the guy who lived geographically really far away. The neighbor was the one who showed up and helped and entered into the brokenness. And so often we find ourselves in the same situation. Will we be good neighbors to the people that we come in contact with? Whether they're in our geography or not, how do we be good neighbors? How do we help them experience the mercy of God? Because like with Assyria, like with the city of Nineveh, God's mercy is moving very quickly into the hearts of every person. That's God's will. That's where he's moving. His spirit is going before us. His desire is to show mercy to every person, even a nation like Assyria, who was full of wickedness. God's mercy moves before us. We are sent to help people see it. And that's our role. So will we be, church, the kind of people who help others see God's mercy? Will we be the kind of people who are willing to let the Spirit take control of that process? And even when we don't understand it, even when it looks a little bit different than how our faith has showed up, will we let the Holy Spirit work mercy in the lives of the people that we encounter? Will we decide to be good neighbors to every person that we possibly can be? And to see what blessings God will shower upon us when we embrace that we are sent to the people in our communities, in our workplaces, in our schools, wherever we go. Let's pray. God, today I'm just very aware of all the different kinds of people, all the different kinds of things that are surrounding our church and our neighborhoods and our communities. And you love each and every one of them. And God, you're already doing something in their hearts in ways that I don't know or I don't understand. God, grant us the courage to be sent out, to go into the lives of people who are just different, lives that we don't fully understand. God, give us the courage to go forward, to get to know people, to hear their stories, to learn from them. And through that, God, may your mercy overflow and change the hearts of everyone that we encounter. And today, God, change our hearts. Open us up to ask the question, who can I be a neighbor to? In your name we pray. Amen.